In this video, I'm going to show you how I draw a fantasy world map. Yeah! Okay, before we jump into planning and drawing our world map, I want to go over a couple of really important details. First thing, my goal with all of these videos is to inspire you to create something to give you the confidence to at least try out making your own map. You don't need to be a professional illustrator or even good at drawing to make a really cool looking world map that you can share with your D&D players or put in your fantasy book or even just post it on Instagram. The point is, I'm gonna lay out all the steps here. If you follow along, you'll be able to do it. I believe in you. I can't wait to see what kind of maps you make. To make a cool world map, you're not gonna need any really fancy supplies. I'm gonna be using just a regular mechanical pencil, eraser. I have a few pens that are different sizes. My go-to Faber-Castell artist pen size F for fine, I think. These you can get at any art supply store, or you can just use regular old gel pens. I got a Jelly Roll pen that I'm excited to try out on this map. You're gonna need a few sheets of just regular paper to do your planning on, and you can totally use these to draw your actual map on, but I am going to be using a sheet of Bristol board. It's basically thicker paper that is meant to be drawn on. This kind of paper you can find at any and all art supply stores as well. And of course, the last thing you're gonna need is your brain, your imagination, which everybody has. What am I talking about? Now, while I was thinking about this video and my approach to map making, I've kind of figure that there's two different types of map making. The first is a realistic map, so we're talking accurate scale and distance and showing topography. If you get really into world building and really need to show how far it is from one place to the other and show the scale of this mountain compared to this city compared to this forest, making a realistic map is probably the way to go. But the other type of map I'm gonna call representational. This kind of map might be considered more decorative or maybe less functional, but it's really about showing off important places and locations. In this kind of map, we're not necessarily concerned with scale or how far it is from place to place. We're more concerned with showing this is where this cool city is, and over here is this giant awesome looking volcano. For me, it's the type of map that I would hand to my D&D players, and hopefully it would spark their imagination of all these cool places we get to explore in this imaginative world. Okay, now that that's all out of the way, let's go start planning our world map. All right, if you've watched any of my other how to make a map videos, or any of my other videos really, you know that I'm all about making lists. So of course the first step is to make a list of all the important locations that are gonna be in your world. So usually my homebrew campaign setting is all about this city called Port Vella, and all of my world building efforts lately have gone into making that city and the surrounding areas awesome for my D&D players to explore. But when it came to planning out a world map, I wasn't quite ready to fill in all of those details. So what I did was just jump on the computer, one of those random generator websites, and I put a list together of 20 cool sounding names. So my list here is a bunch of cities, a bunch of the big landmarks like the mountains and the forests and the swamps, all that kind of stuff. Really, the point is, the map I'm making today is going to be completely randomly generated. This isn't my homebrewed world that a ton of thought has gone into. I'm just trying to make a really cool looking, inspiring, thought-provoking world map. All right, so I've jumped on my sheet of Bristol board and I'm starting super basic. I'm super simply, absolutely zero detail, penciling in the land masses on this map. So as I was looking over this list of pretty much randomly generated names of places, I thought they kind of fell into the sort of standard, nice sounding names. You know, places like Windsong Bay and Shieldstone. And then there were the dark, chaotic, more evil sounding names like Void's Maw and Everdusk Keep. So I decided to split the map into two kind of continent island places. And really, that's my starting point. Just two big islands, and then I'm going to build up the detail from there. So I'm adding mountain ranges and forest, and I'm just putting little circles in for where the town goes. I'm starting to label things. You know, it starts off as the most basic shapes, and then as I go, I'm erasing, adding in a little more detail, and really just using this step of the process to plan out where everything goes on the map. So it's important at this stage that you don't get too caught up in the drawing. I started having fun with it, drawing some of these cities and stuff, but really this is just planning. Don't worry about the drawing. We'll get to that in the next part. You know, remember that this is a fantasy map, and as you're planning, you can really do whatever you want. But at the same time, you know, gravity does exist in this world, so there's some rules of water flows from higher elevation to lower elevation. So I have my rivers coming out of the mountain ranges and flowing towards the bay and the lake areas. You know, simple stuff like that. I'm not getting too caught up on making this thing super realistic. So the last thing is I'm calling this the Queen's Realm. I live in Cincinnati, which is also called the Queen City, and I thought that would just be a fun, evocative name to give these two islands. Like, who is this queen that rules over these two very different places? And then just to give this map a little more interest, it's always fun to add in a compass rose. I think that's what it's called, compass rose, the little north, south, east, west thing. It's a fun design element to take your map to the next level. Okay, I'm really happy with the planning stage of the map. I kind of got a little more into the details than I expected. It's okay to be looser than this at this point. Really, what's important is you just have each location indicated on your map, sketched out somewhere. Now we're gonna put the sketch aside, go back to our list of places, and really figure out how we're gonna draw all these cool locations on our map. All right, let's make a key for the map. Okay, the whole point of this step in the process is for you to figure out what everything is gonna look like without having to draw directly on your map and be afraid of messing things up. Now that we've already planned everything out, all I'm doing is making a list of the different types of terrain and locations that I'm going to need for the map, and I'm just figuring out how to draw them on this scrap sheet of paper. Now, you can keep everything super simple, like the mountains can just be these little upside down V's, forests can just be squiggly clouds with little stick tree trunks coming out of the bottom, swamps and water, and even towns and cities can just be symbols, basically, and it's still gonna look super awesome once you fill in the entire map with all this stuff. Like I said at the beginning, the whole idea of this video is to show you that even with no drawing skill whatsoever, you can make a super cool map using these really simple shapes and symbols to fill out what you've already planned from the last step. But for this map, I'm gonna take it one step further and get a little more detailed with my terrain types. So I'm keeping the mountains kind of still pointy, but I'm just adding a little more variation and then doing this kind of line down the center and texture on one side just to give it a little more depth. For the trees, instead of just drawing a blob, I'm drawing like individual trees that are still just blobs with sticks, but I'm layering them and kind of having them be in perspective going back by overlapping them. The swamps are basically the same thing, just a little more detailed. And for the towns and cities, I'm just gonna draw little buildings to sort of indicate what kind of place you can expect when you go there. There's probably gonna be more variations of this on the final map, but for now, this is a good indication of just a few of the differences between the towns and cities and stuff. These are really the most complicated things I'm gonna be drawing on this map, but really the whole point of this step of the process is if you take just a little bit of time to figure out how to draw these pieces, you're just gonna be filling them in on the map, and it's really not that difficult. I promise you, if you just take the time, you can do it. A side note, if you clicked on this video looking for very specific information on how to draw each and every little part of a fantasy map, don't worry. I have a video coming up soon all about how to draw different types of mountains and forests and all kinds of terrain types. Go ahead and give me a subscribe and hit the notification bell and you'll be alerted as soon as the new videos go up. All right, we have the sketch of our map. We got the list of all our locations and now the key of how everything's gonna look. Before we get to drawing though, I wanna talk a little bit about lettering. Now when we jump back over into our map, the first thing we're gonna be cleaning up is the lettering because all the other drawings are gonna be around the letters. All right, the only real consideration you need to have when lettering your map, the type needs to be easily readable and clearly label the specific piece of terrain or location on the map that you're going for. What we're doing on this map is lettering. We're taking the time to illustrate the letters on the map. So really all that means is you're trying to keep each letter the same height and width and the spacing in between the letters the same. If you just take your time with it, try to keep it consistent, I promise you it'll look awesome. All right, that's the end of my lettering rant. Let's continue on with drawing this map. All right, now it's time to take one little section at a time and clean everything up. So I'm erasing, I'm refining, I'm drawing my different types of terrain around the lettering that I've already done. I tend to find that getting the mountains in there first really helps build everything else around it. You know, the water flows from the mountains, the trees go up against the mountains. So yeah, using my key, I'm just taking one section at a time and sort of filling out the map, cleaning it up, making everything look good in pencil. And this whole part of the process is really a confidence thing. So if I was more confident, I would be able to jump in straight with a pen and go to town. But because I want to make sure everything's planned out, looking good, I'm sticking with pencil and doing my refining in this stage. As we go along, you'll see that I am leaving sections out. Like I decide that I don't need to draw every single little tree. That is something that I'm confident enough to handle when I get into the inking phase. I'm not doing any of the detail of the coastlines. That I can handle drawing straight and pen. But yeah, this is just a really satisfying part of the process. You get to see your map come alive. You feel like you're actually making a map at this point instead of just planning things. You know, you're not sure how it's gonna look, but at this stage I'm getting an idea of how it's gonna look and I'm pretty psyched on it. The other thing to mention is don't be afraid to erase and change your mind completely on something. So I'm just going for it, and because I don't have a bunch of lore and stuff in my head about all these places, it really frees me up to just create whatever I want and throw it on there and not have to think about it too much. But if you need to erase and replan, rework stuff, this is the time to do it. That's what this whole part of the process is for, is getting everything looking just how you want it to look. Building up your confidence, take your time with it, have fun. Drawing's awesome, making maps is awesome. I love this stuff, yeah. Okay, now that the penciling is all done, map's looking good, this next step is gonna seem kinda crazy. I'm erasing the pencils. But not all the way. I'm using this little gray eraser. It's called a kneaded eraser. It's really good at lightening up dark pencil marks without completely erasing them or smudging them everywhere. I guess you could use a normal eraser, but I think a kneaded eraser is really the best thing for this kind of step. Or you could just be better than me and not draw really heavy-handed with a super dark pencil. But regardless, I've erased all the pencil lines, so now I have this nice, light, barely visible map, and I'm finally ready to start inking. All right, the first step when putting ink to paper is doing the lettering. I'm just using my Faber-Castell Pitt Artist pen size F to do this. I tend to think that a pen that has a uniform line is usually best for lettering. Like I said before, lettering is all about taking it slow. You're not writing the words, you're drawing them. So trying to keep everything even and consistent. The whole point of this is to make a hand-drawn map. Put the time and care into it. It's okay if it's a little bit wonky. It's gonna look better when the entire map is hand-drawn and everything is consistent, you know, looks like the same person that drew the map also wrote the letters. Next up is just like the sketch phase, I'm starting with the outlines. For this, I'm using a thicker pen. I was just gonna double up the line with the Pitt Artist pen, but I went and grabbed a brush pen, making the sort of continent outline or island outline thicker than everything else. So this way the continents or the land masses will really stand out against everything. Now it's time to get into the meat of the drawing of this map. I'm drawing all of the terrain, the mountains, trees, the cities, all the stuff. I am gonna leave the details, shading, I guess, the smaller stuff for later. Right now I'm just focused on filling in all of the space. We'll add the details later. Of course, this part takes the longest, so you kind of have to go into Zen mode, especially when drawing all of the little trees. You kind of just have to shut your mind off and go for it. But the cool thing is, this is when your map is really gonna come alive. All of the details and the planning is coming to life, and we get to start to see what the map is actually gonna look like. So remember that none of this drawing is that complicated. You know, all these little trees and stuff are just little circle triangle things. There's the swamp is just little bushes, and the mountains are just jagged upside down V's. And the thing that's gonna make this map look awesome is filling in all of the space with these simple drawings. And the complexity of the map is the amount of fun stuff going on, not the complexity of the actual illustration. All right, once the main portion of the inking is done, I'm gonna go ahead and erase the pencils as best I can. At this point, I don't need any of the pencil guidelines, the planning part of the pencils. I don't need it anymore to fill in the rest of the little details. And the main reason I'm erasing now is that I don't know how the pen I'm gonna use to fill in the details, how that's gonna hold up against the eraser, because the lines are so thin. I don't wanna erase those lines off the page. So I'm erasing now before I get into the final details. Okay, I'm putting down my Pitt Artist pen and I'm picking up my jelly roll. So I'm using this pen to fill in all of the details. I'm kind of putting shadows on the sides of the mountains, giving the swamps a little more texture, making the cliffs look more like cliffs. Really, this is just another way to fill in some of the empty spaces and give the map some shading. I'm not using any color or anything. I'm keeping this map black and white. So by kind of doing these hatch marks, it's almost like I'm adding a gray tone to certain parts of the map. And now I'm moving on to the ocean and really pushing that idea of adding a sort of mid-tone color with texture by doing these horizontal lines in the oceans. So if you squint your eyes, it kind of makes this gray color that pops these island continents off of the map even more than just the thick black outline. I hope this is a successful technique that looks good. It probably would look even better if I spent more time on it, and you know, I should have tested it out in the pencil phase, but I'm just going for it here. This is just another example of all the possible ways of illustrating fantasy maps. I really want to encourage you to try stuff out. Draw oceans with just horizontal lines, or illustrate big waves, or just do the little squiggle thing. You know, just experiment, have fun, imagine awesome places that you can travel to in your D&D adventures, or crazy places for your characters and your fantasy novels to explore. And I know I sound like a broken record, but even if you think you can't draw, I promise you, if you're just patient, do the planning, put in some time, you can make an awesome looking fantasy map. Yeah. All right, the Queen's Realm is completed. So I am super happy with this map. Actually, it was a really fun experience just making a list of random places and then creating a map and filling it with those insanely named locations. Honestly, it makes me want to run a D&D campaign in this world. I wanna know who the queen is and what what she's up to. I want to adventure in the Emberspire Mountains and see what's at the bottom of the Void's Maw. What's the deal with the Shifting Tower? And is there something cool going on at Rose Lake? I mean, that's the super fun thing about making these maps, is it's just really simple drawings stacked on top of each other, adding more and more detail that just gets your imagination going like crazy. Okay, let me know if you have any questions about this whole process down in the comments below. Again, I have some more videos planned on how to draw different pieces and parts of maps and stuff. And if this video inspires you to make a map, please, please, please send it to me on social media. All that info is down in the description below. I would love more than anything to see the maps that you make. Okay, that's it for this one. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. See ya!